My name is Pat Ryerson. I play lock for the Missoula Maggots. And just out here, going to explain a little bit about set kicks, kicking for points, and also my scrum cap, which likes to cover my ears so my ears don't get ripped off. That's quite essential in rugby, but no, it's actually just so I don't get lock burns, and it minor padding for myself. So going through a set kick, I like to kick off the ground. So usually what I do is dig my heel in the ground, place the ball at pretty much a 90 degree angle from the ground, and I usually take 3 steps back, 1 back, 2 over. I look at the post because I'm trying to make it in between the 2 goal posts, and I come up to the ball. All I'm trying to do is focus, plant my foot, and make contact right about here. So, little demonstration here. I'll do a quick one.
My name is Alex, and this is Andy. I play for the Missoula All Maggots in Missoula, Montana. The website is www.maggots.org. And now we're going to do a real simple ball works passing, the right and the left hand. A lot of players only know how to pass one or the other, down or hand. Really simple way to learn how to do this is take it one hand first, stand about 5 or 6 feet apart, and roll it off one hand, two apart, back one hand, and switch hands. And get the same simple roll. It's really easy stuff. One hand when you're passing is supposed to just be a guide. The other hand is all the work. It should really only be one hand pass. Practice it. In the game, all passes are with 2 hands. Next step from that, 2 hands on the ball, but one is just a guide. It's really just a one hand spiral. Switch hands. Simple as that. Now we're going to look closely at the one-hand spin pass. Just for practicing purposes, learn how to spin pass with both hands. So the one hand here, holding like this, kind of the back half of the ball, and rolling it, comes back. And switch hands, same position on the other hand, and you roll it, and that's it. Simple as that. My name is Alex, this is Andy. I'm from Missoula All Maggots in Missoula, Montana. Visit our website at www.maggots.org. In this clip, we're going to try to properly catch the ball off of a kick. It's important in this one to turn your body. Kick it coming from this direction, you're going to turn your body like this and catch the ball coming down towards you. But if you drop the ball or fumble a little bit, it's not going to come forward, it's going to go backward. So you're not knocking the ball along, losing possession. It's also important here, turn your body like this so you're giving your shoulder, your knee, your hip, all the hard spots. Don't give your stomach or your face. These guys are from tackling right away. Just the ball up in the air. Like that. Another one. Right. Bring it in like that. Catching it down, dragging it to your hip. And you're ready to run. For the Missoula All Maggots in Missoula, Montana. Today we're going to learn some things about picking the ball up on the run and some of the basic concepts. To start off with, when you're running onto the ball, there's 2 main things you have to think about. One, how am I going to not knock the ball along with possession immediately? And 2, how am I going to cover up so I'm not immediately hit and hurt? So the first thing you have to do is come into the ball, the leading hand drags it back to the other, and you tuck it up under for a run. That way you're not exposing any of your tender parts, like your stomach and your face. Lead in with the shoulder, the knee, and the hip. You're dragging it backward like that, you're not going to knock the ball on. A little faster now. My name is Alex, this is Andy. I'm from Missoula All Maggots in Missoula, Montana. The website is www.maggots.org. And now we're going to have a problem, take the ball into a tackle. Running with the ball in open field, two hands in the ball, take a pass either direction. As soon as you realize the tackle's going to be made, you're in a tackle situation, you're going to bring the ball back, secure it, and lead in with the hard parts of your body, the elbow, the hip, the knee, and secure the stomach and the face. Back here, you come in, this, that's proper. You try and drive through the tackle a little bit, so when you fall, vent the ball back to your side. You're in the open field, you carry the ball in two hands, take a pass left or right, switch to a tackle situation. You can secure the ball, lead in with your knee, your elbow, your hip, not show your stomach or your face. You can drive through a tackle, come right to the side, so you can vent the ball to your own team. Alex, from Missoula All Maggots in Missoula, Montana. Today we're going to learn some things about picking the ball up on the run and some of the basic concepts. To start off with, when you're running onto the ball, there's two main things you have to think about. One, how am I going to not knock the ball along with possession immediately? Two, how am I going to cover up so I'm not immediately hit and hurt? So the first thing you have to do is come into the ball, the leading hand drags back to the other, and you tuck it up under for a run. That way you're not exposing any of your tender parts, like your stomach and your face. Lead in with the shoulder, the knee, and the hip. You're dragging it backward like that, you're not going to knock the ball on. A little faster now. That's it.
Pat Ryerson with the Missoula Maggots. This is Andy Smith. He's going to be holding a rucking bag. This is Alex Baer, and he's going to be holding the tackling dummy. We're going to be doing the Gordo drill, and what it is, it's practicing our rucking skills on this pad right here. So I come in, I'll be coming in on this side, and I'll hit him, grab a leg, and push him over a rock. Then I come up to this one, and this is a tackle. And that's the basic function. You run down and back, and that's the basic function of a ruck being established and also a tackle. Visit the Maggots at www.maggots.org. And now I'll demonstrate the drill. Quite key to wear a mouthpiece, everyone. You don't want to lose your teeth. I like my teeth. I like to eat corn on the cob.
Well done.
Hi, this is Sean Hobson for Expert Village. What we want to talk about right now is when our defensive tackle is in pursuit of a tackle, once he's shed the block, we want to make sure that we take our proper angle of pursuit. And what we're talking about here is we never want to go ahead, let's just go ahead and block and shed the block. Go ahead, block, shed the block. Now, as the running back is coming, we never want this guy to run right at the running back, because what's going to happen is this guy's going to get the outside angle and he's going to be able to run out and around our defensive tackle. So what we want to make sure and do is, go ahead and come back up in here. What we want to make sure and do is when he sheds the block, we want him to take the proper angle and try to meet this guy where he's going and put a good stop on him. So we're going to show you what this looks like in live form. Set, put. He's going to shed the block and then he's going to take the proper angle. He's going to make a good tackle. You always want to make sure that you meet that running back where he's going. Don't ever come straight at him and give him an opportunity to outrun you to the side, because in most cases, your defensive tackle is not going to be able to outrun a running back. So take the proper angle, help yourself out, and then make a big tackle.
Would it be possible to recreate the effects of a multiple car pileup using the information we'd already gathered on a rugby pitch?
Big bunch of girls to me. Big bunch of girls.
To recreate our pileup, the players will position themselves in a semicircle around the guinea pig, like so. They're then going to hurl themselves into the guinea pig from a variety of angles, and while not being strictly accurate in terms of weight or speed ratios, they're near enough, and we should see some really spectacular results. Especially if Ollie keeps on calling the front row a bunch of girlies.
You're a big bunch of girls, are you?
Apparently, I'm simulating a car, and I'm going to find out what it's going to be like in a multiple pileup.
This is a very good simulation of a real car accident. Ollie is completely unaware of what's about to hit him, and is therefore unable to brace himself for the impact. This is a classic example of what happens to the human body in a rear-end collision. Ollie's body is moving faster than his head, and as a result, he's about to suffer in a very minor form one of the most common injuries, whiplash. But why is Ollie in such pain, while the players are able to get straight up? Well, the players are distributing the energy of the impact all along the skeleton, from shoulder to toe. Ollie, on the other hand, is absorbing the energy into his midriff and ribcage, neither of which is designed for such heavy impact.
Which may account for his possible broken rib.
And he's half the size of me.
Nick, you've been there a bunch of girls.
No.
Nick, you see me climb, mate.
It's all right, guys, you can rent him by the hour.
It's still a bunch of girls. Right, it's my turn to partake in this multiple pile-up fun. I'm representing a motorbike today. The safety word is Mesopotamia.
As you might have guessed, because Nicky is smaller, the energy of the impact makes him travel even further. Of course, as in any good science, the only way to confirm this is to repeat the experiment. Another 7 times. In the space of half an hour, we saw the guinea pigs break a collarbone, sustain a possible rib fracture, and whiplash. Even under our control circumstances, with health and safety experts on site, injuries can still occur. Remember, the guinea pigs suffer, so you don't have to.
Mesopotamia.
Hello, I'm Miriam, and this is Bess, and we are showing you some basic rugby techniques. These are to do with running the ball. Right now, I'm showing you how to get around a defender. What you would want to use is something called a sidestep. You want to take the ball towards the defender, fake to one side, go to the other. So here we are. We're going to run in, fake a step to the inside, go to the outside. We're going to show you that again a little bit faster. We're going to run in, fake a step to the inside, go to the outside.
Now we're going to simulate a ruck, and the pattern represents the player taking the ball into the tackle. Andy is the tackler on the opposite team. Instead of picking up the ball and moving with it, we're going to try and clear this player off of the ball. So we have a good clean ruck, and our player team come into the ball and take his ball cleanly away. So we're going to start with a good distance back, see some good running room, get some good speed, come into the ball, step over your player, come underneath, ruck him off the ball like this. In a competitive tackle situation, step over the player, come underneath, ruck over the ball.
Hey,
Hi, my name is Miriam, and today we're going to be talking about some basic rugby skills. This is Bess, and she's going to be helping me show you the proper technique for tackling. Well, today we're going to be doing it standing still, which is how you would first practice. Of course, in a game, you would be doing this while running. You want to face the person you're tackling. You want to get low, and to make sure you're low enough, remember, cheek to cheek, get down, wrap your arms all the way around, squeeze, a little bit of pressure, and down they go. And now we're going to show you a tackle at full speed.
My name is Alex, and this is Andy. I play for the Missoula All Maggots in Missoula, Montana. The website is www.maggots.org. And now we're going to learn how to do a real simple ball works passing, the right and the left hand. A lot of players only know how to pass one or the other, down or hand. Really simple way to learn how to do this is take it one hand first, stand about 5 or 6 feet apart, and roll it off one hand, two apart, back one hand, and switch hands. Trying to get the same simple roll. It's really easy stuff. One hand when you're passing is supposed to just be a guide. The other hand is all the work. It should really only be one hand pass. Practice it. In the game, all passes are with two hands. Next step from that, two hands on the ball, one is just a guide. It's really just one hand spiraling. Switch hands. Simple as that.
Now we're going to look closely at the one-hand spin pass. Just for practicing purposes, learn how to spin pass with both hands. So the one hand here, holding like this, kind of the back half of the ball, and rolling it, comes back. And switch hands, same position on the other hand, and you roll it, and that's it.
Simple as that. My name is Alex, this is Andy, we're from Missoula All Maggots. Website is www.maggots.org. And now we're going to learn how to do the proper tackle technique.
Okay, so what you need to do in order to tackle correctly, the first thing you do is get low. Always get low. And that, you know, there's really no substitute for that. Anything else, you're high, you have no control. If I try to tackle him here, he can shed me like it's nothing. If I get low and I want to try to tackle his hips, he can't go anywhere. So when he's coming into me, I'm going to get low, first of all. I'm going to want to keep my head to the outside. If I bring my head across his body like this, yeah, knee to the face, you're just putting your neck out there, bad position, bad situation to be in. So you want to be here, keep your head to the outside, step into him, wrap him up, very important. You wrap him up and then drive through, just like that.
My name is Alex, I'm from Missoula All Maggots in Missoula, Montana. And I learned how to do the kick to touch, spiraling long kick, and try and gain some territory in the field. This kick is really also very simple. I want the ball again to point up above the dominant foot towards the dominant shoulder. And then come across the ball, striking it higher off the ground, the previous kick we talked about. And then come across the ball, kicking it almost to the outside of your foot, but still with the middle end as well. Put your cones in distance again, out of sideline to try and get an idea of where you have to put the ball. Get some target to think about. In this take, we're going to show you how to slow motion kick this ball, kicking for touch for a long spiraling kick. This is good to use. We're trying to gain touch, trying to gain some territory in the field. Penalty plays, good one to use for your line out. In this case, the ball is going to be pointing up towards your shoulder again, and you kick the ball a little higher off the ground than for the drop kick and for the grubber. And you come across the ball with your foot, putting a spiral to it. My name is Alex, this is Andy, this is St. John Dog. We all play for the Missoula All Maggots in Missoula, Montana. Two types of passes in the field, for the most part. First one's long, spiraling ball. Those are for the backs, scrum after the fly half, get some distance in the pass and still get some good accuracy. The second pass is a simple pop pass, so we're going to show you right now. Two hands in the ball, fingers down towards the point, and show no rotation on this ball. It should really easily run onto, easily caught. It's just like that. That's all it is. Get a friend a couple feet apart, pass back and forth. It's not so much your elbows and your shoulders, it's more your wrists and your popping your fingers. Exactly. You get better with that, a little distance between you, try and keep without rotation, a little flick of the wrists. That's all it is.
I'm Miriam, and this is the Better Side Rugby Club, and we're showing you some basic rugby plays. Right now, this is the ruck. When you take the ball into contact and you put the ball down on the ground, it's a ruck. So here we're going to show it to you very slowly. I'm going to take the ball in against the defender. I'm going to place the ball on the ground, and my team's going to push over the ball so that the next person can come and pick it up and go with it. Place it on the ground. And my teammates are going to help me push over the ball so it can be picked up by the next player who can take it on. Now we're going to show the same thing a little bit faster. And that's how you do a ruck.
My name is Alex, they're from Missoula All Maggots, from Missoula, Montana, and now we're going to learn how to do a simple drop kick. So the drop kick is scoring time in the game, 3 easy points. The simple thing about this is, the ball touches the ground, as soon as it does, you want to make sure you strike it, put it through the upright. So, you want the ball when you drop it, point it back up towards your shoulder, like your dominant foot. That way the ball is going to bounce a little bit towards you, not away from your foot. Really simple. Show you one here. Okay, now we're going to show you slowly how to kick a drop kick. Again, the ball you want, when you drop the ball, the point of the ball up over your dominant shoulder, over your dominant foot. You want to drop, hit the ground, simply like this, and come back towards your foot a little bit. You're kicking the ball, this part of your foot in here, much like you would a good striker for a soccer ball. Show you that right here. My name is Alex, this is Andy, we're from Missoula All Maggots in Missoula, Montana, www.maggots.org. In this drill, I'm just going to probably pick the ball up, right hand and left hand, not to knock it on. Run a couple of steps, place the ball with two hands under control as you would when you're scoring a try. Next person runs through, does the same thing, runs past the first person, looping run down the length of the field. With fitness, placing the ball under control, and also picking the ball up in the run. That's it.
Hello, I'm Miriam, and this is Bess and Jen, and we're showing you some basic rugby techniques. Right now, we're going to show you how to bind in a ruck. First, we're going to show you as if you are the defender, so we're coming towards you. Jen's going to come forward, place the ball as if she's rucking, and then both Bess and I are going to follow. Bess will come first, and she'll grab her around the waist and shorts. She gets low with her arms and is able to push. I'll come around, grab across onto Bess, get my shoulder low, and we can both push. And now we're going to show you from another angle. And now from behind.
Okay, so hello, it's Dan here from Stuff.tv, and we've come down to the Harlequins training ground at Roehampton to learn how to kick conversions with Chris Malone, the Harlequins fly half.
First of all, you're going to take the ball like that, so you have the seam facing where you want it to go, towards the post. Place it on the tee, straight as you... So that seam still is pointing to the target. Then what I do is I just tilt the ball slightly to the right. If you're a left footer, you'll do exactly the same on the other side. Then I just check to make sure that it's pointing the way I want it to go. Then I address the ball, my left foot, which will be my plant foot, next to the ball, and look to see where I'm going to kick it, and I step away. I take three steps at a 45 degree angle away from the ball. Now I'm ready to kick it. I look towards the post, just visualize the ball going through the post. So that's my target, that's where I want the ball to go. After I've done that, I've got that vision in my mind, I look back at the ball, and I'm now concentrating on the spot on the ball where I want to kick it. Then I approach the ball. I'll just walk it now because I'm not running, and plant that foot again. Then the important part is here. You want to have your head over the ball, so you don't want to be sitting back here. You don't want to be too far forward. You want to have your head over the ball, and as you kick the ball, you want to follow through at the target. So ideally, away from it would be there. Follow through at the target and keep coming forward. That takes your momentum through the ball.
Okay.
And so now Dan's going to try it. So there you have it. That's goal kicking. Dan, exceptional. 3 points you need to remember. One, place the ball facing the target. I have a slight lean to the side, that may suit you, it may not. Then you take three steps away from the ball at a 45 degree angle, feel comfortable with your run up, and then the most important thing is as you approach the ball, you've got your head down, you get over the ball and you follow through at the target.
So, as you can see, it's quite a lot harder than it looks on TV, but just remember Chris's top three tips: the stride, the swing and the strike, and you'll be kicking like a pro in no time. That's all from us here. Keep checking stuff.tv for more how-to guides.
The key coaching points are back foot in tight to the ball, bent knee and backside down with weight transfer from the back leg to the front leg upon sweeping the pass. Ball to be passed off the deck, fingers to point at target, point and shoot. After the pass, the support line is to follow the line of the ball. Maintain technique when fatigued. Look for consistent quality of ball delivery. Be aware of the player favouring a passing side.
Wait for him, Benny.
Then I'll wait.
Go, last one!
players work one-on-one against each other initially, then move to two attackers on one defender. Key coaching points are defenders should have their hands up with weight on the balls of their feet. Drive through and up with the legs. Chin should be up, locking the back into a strong position. Shoulder-to-shoulder contact. The lead arm of the player driving out should aggressively force through, smashing the window formed by the defender's arms.
Hello, my name's Brian Moore.
And I'm Jeremy Gascott.
We're here today with the boys from the Hampstead School, North London, to explain some of the basic techniques of rugby. This drill is set up quite simply by making a rectangle with the cone so the boys can run in between the lines. The outside men obviously running on the outside, and the man in the middle is turning at each end so he gets to pass both ways.
Good.
So we just want it in a nice place. So when you catch it, it's all in one movement. It's going to go across to your teammate over there, who should be creating a target for you as well. You're going to make a target for him, is it okay, when he gets the ball?
Yes. Arms all the way through, finish it off. Good, that's good. Well done. Finish it off, good. Hands up. Finish the pass off, right the way through, good. Good, and back, turn. Yes.
Very casual, maybe a little bit forward.
Next two there.
Just going
back, right?
Two there. So
the defender.
Oh, laces.
Getting a bit cold, lad.
The two-on-one drill is to make sure that the defender is fixed in his position before the ball is passed to the outside man. The setup for this again, you can do it on the rectangle. Make sure the defender goes around the far cone before the boys set off to do the two-on-one passing.
Not bad, not bad. Defender!
When you're running at the defender, you've got to run for his inside shoulder. If Jerry's a defender, and to say that as a clutch line, and I start to do this, what happens? Drifts over, he's got no space, this man gets clattered when he gets the ball, or I get clattered. That's his inside shoulder, you've got to run there so he can't move, and then it goes. Then he's got all that room, yeah? Attack his inside shoulder there, and there.
Rain me. Inside shoulder.
Well
done, not bad. Attack his inside shoulder. Well done. Deep. Good work. So what you remember is you carry the ball in two hands, you take the defender where you want him. If you're carrying the ball, someone's coming to you, so you have to realise that they're going to follow you wherever you go. So you have to make as much space for your other player. So that's why you run at the inside shoulder. And then just remember the fundamentals of passing. A simple one is catching. So to catch, you've got to make a target.
Yep.
And the quicker you can do it, the quicker you can transfer the ball from the target to the next target, the quicker the ball's going to go down the line and you can attack. So keep on practicing that skill.
Nice and steady, good lad. No limit at this level.
Tim, first minute I walked in, and then he took me under his wing, training-wise.
Yeah, that's what it's all about.
I was training with him for 45 minutes and leave 2.5 hours later. I talked to him all the time about things, mostly none of them about rugby.
I think Schroeder. He wants to be the best player in the world. And he wants to be the best player that's ever been in his position. He's far off fulfilling that goal, really. But it's something that
Elvis used to use him on his legs.
It's hard, isn't it? That way.
That way.
Yeah, that's up and down.
Oh, God.
Thank you.
Same. Yoda's going to hold the ground, crouch and hold in the perfect setup position. The partner will come in, there'll be no hands on the knees. For 30 seconds, the partner will try and lift him, move him, and get him out of line. Tension right throughout. Away you go, 30 seconds. Boys just looking here at Yoda and Kevy again. You've done them before, but we haven't done them for a while. Now here, I just want to make sure that we're tense in the chest, lock the core, be absolutely fixed through here. One, two, three, up. Come up in the perfect scrummaging position, slowly lower it to your knees, hit the ground, all the way down and relax. Then start again by tensing, and up. Just do half dozen, boys. Again, boys, really work on the tension. For those who haven't seen it, one guy will fall. Taking down low, make sure your hips are forward. I'll just take one hand off. Don't move, just 30 seconds. Away you go, boys. Bring the big fella down. Change. That's it. Next, just line up on the line here, boys.
Good.
This next drill you haven't done, just come on in a bit. Nay, you're just going to go about 10 metres trying to drive them backwards. They're going to resist about 95%. If you guys happen to twist and move, you straighten them up, Nay. Away you go. Yeah, let them get a wee bit of move. That's it. Square it up. Keep in control of our move. That's beautiful.
Beautiful Nay. Nice Nay. Tremendous. Well done, Nay.
Shot silver back.
Good boy. Where you go? Don't stand up to push. Stay low. There you go. That's good. That's good. We're going to keep it strong. Good. Good. Good, Zag. Great. Well done, Zag. Yeah, keep your dribbles hard. It's a bloody good thing. We've only got a few minutes, we're just going to finish with putting a few hits together. Now boys, what are we after? All I want is our ball today. What are we after? Speed and constant pressure, okay? Now, and if it happens to move a wee bit, we stay strong. Crouch and hold, engage. Break, crouch and hold, engage.
Good lift. Lock,
crouch and hold. Engage! 8 of us on, boys. 8 of us on. Our ball.
2 ball.
Crouch and hold. Engage!
Keep it on.
Tension toes. Get out speed.
Ready, no lock.
Crouch and hold. Engage! Good boy. Keep it on. Crouch and hold. Engage. Crouch and hold. Engage.
Ready, Rip.
Crouch and hold. Engage. Good. Nails a double shunt. Well done, boys.
Three defenders start in a staggered Indian file against four attackers. The first defender always lines up on the first attacker. The two back defenders can change their starting position to vary the attacking options. Key coaching points for attackers are maintain depth in support of ball carrier and communicate options. Change angle onto the pass to hit holes. Point and shoot at target with pass. Key coaching points for defenders are hands up and move forward on the inside of the ball carrier, keeping eyes on hips or shorts. Balance forward on the balls of the feet. Bend through hips and knees to allow rapid change of direction.
It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA. Thanks to Force 15. That was Drill of the Week, thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA. It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA, thanks to Force 15.
G'day, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. This drill is often used by the Emirates Western Force to practice speed through the hands and precision passing. A quick transfer of the ball will be the result of receiving the ball in front and transferring the ball across the body immediately. The role of the defence is simply to apply pressure. To extend the drill, just increase the width of the grid. Remember, practice the skill and not the drill.
That was Drill of the Week, thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA. It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA, thanks to Force 15.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. This is a very basic drill that can be used to introduce the catch and quick pass across the body. As the drill clearly demonstrates, the active players are attempting to maintain a straight running line whilst catching and transferring the ball. Obviously, there's very little pressure on the active player. Therefore, this drill is great for teaching and practicing the basic skill of catch and pass. Remember, practice the skill and not the drill.
That was Drill of the Week, thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA. It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA, thanks to Force 15.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. This is a tackle technique drill that focuses on the low wrap tackle. Each defender should sight the target, hit with the shoulder, stick by wrapping the arms around the attacker, and then squeeze the arms together to lock the ball carrier's legs. Once the tackle is completed, the defender should use the ball carrier's momentum to spring to his feet and attack the ball. The focus should be safe and efficient tackle technique. Remember, practice the skill and not the drill.
That was Drill of the Week, thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA. It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA, thanks to Force 15.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. This is a continuous drill that covers a number of skills in our game. The acting half digs the ball out of the tyre in a similar style to digging the ball out of a messy ruck. The receiver should practice the timing of their run. After receiving the ball is placed in the tyre and the player should adopt a strong position over the ball. The next arrival gets lower than the defender and executes an efficient clean out. After the clean out has occurred, the drill continues. Remember, practice the skills and not the drill.
That was Drill of the Week, thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA. It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA, thanks to Force 15.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. This is a contact drill that works on pre and post contact as well as individual fitness. In a 5x5 metre grid, the ball carrier makes contact with his hips relatively square. This will ensure the ball carrier is able to continue with his leg drive. When the ball carrier goes to ground, he must ensure he lands on his side and not roll onto his back. The next movement for the ball carrier should be to recoil at the waist and then long place the ball. The ball carrier should get to his feet and repeat the skill at the other side of the grid. Remember, practice the skill and not the drill.
That was Drill of the Week, thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA. It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA, thanks to Force 15.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. In a 10x10 metre grid, four players stand on each cone. The drill begins when the player passes the ball to the player on his left. He must then chase his pass to the cone he threw it to, turn and head back to his starting point to receive the next pass. This simple drill gives the players the opportunity to practice their catch and pass skills whilst fatiguing. Coaches should ensure that players reverse the direction of the pass to practice both sides. Remember, practice the skill and not the drill.
That was Drill of the Week, thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA. It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA. Thanks to Force 15.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. A ball carrier and a latcher stand opposite two pairs of defenders holding hit shields. The ball carrier runs between the two bag holders. He needs to ensure that upon contact, the ball carrier has lowered his posture, has a strong base, and maintains square hips. The latcher grips the ball carrier with a full arm bind and provides power. After breaking through the defenders, the attackers run around a cone, turn, and repeat the activity running back the other way. The attackers should focus on staying on their feet and maintaining their leg drive. Remember, practice the skill and not the drill.
That was Drill of the Week. Thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA. It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA. Thanks to Force 15.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. This drill focuses on strength and stability in contact and freeing the arms to pass to a supporter. In a 5x5 metre grid, two attackers work against one designated defender. The attackers must initiate contact with a strong base and keep the defender away from the ball. This should ensure a clean pass to the supporter. The defender's role is to disrupt the pass or steal the ball. The focus should always be on ball security. Remember, practice the skill and not the drill.
That was Drill of the Week. Thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA. It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA. Thanks to Force 15.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. This passing drill focuses on high repetitions of left and right passing. One player continuously feeds one of two balls to the main passer. The main passer works left and right passing continuously. The extra ball is passed back to the drill feeder by the inactive player. To mix the drill up, the feeder can place the ball on the ground or drop them down similar to that of a line-out. After 1 minute, change the main passer. Remember, practice the skill and not the drill.
That was Drill of the Week. Thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA. It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA. Thanks to Force 15.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. This is a long-placed drill focusing on the tackle player being able to manoeuvre his body with a tackler on top. In a 5x5 metre grid, set out four different coloured marker cones. The coach calls out a colour and the tackled players need to place the ball in the direction of that coloured cone. The ball carrier must maintain their core strength, whilst the tackler's role is to lie on the ball carrier. This drill promotes strength on the ground in the long place. Remember, practice the skill and not the drill.
That was Drill of the Week. Thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA.
Hi, I'm Simon Namey from the Rugby World Fitness Factory. This section of videos concentrates on the rugby-specific conditioning aspect of training. With any training, there is the risk of injury, so if you don't know what you're doing, you must seek professional help. Every time you train, it's really important that you also warm up properly and cool down. Medicine ball drills. These exercises help to develop explosive power in all the major movement patterns for rugby. They can be used in circuits to develop specific conditioning. Let's look at some of the drills that we do with the medicine balls. session. Make sure you come back for the next video.
Sports conditioning credits include 2 years with the Newcastle Knights, he's done 2 years with the Parramatta Eels, he's done a year with the Northern Eagles, he's also been involved in the Sydney Kings, and has also been one of Australia's leading strength and conditioning experts for the last 20 years. He's always been one of my weight training mentors, and you'll see why tonight with information Ashley has. I'd like to introduce Mr. Ashley Jones.
Thank you, Paul Wright. It's always a pleasure. He gets a bit verbose. Basically this evening, I think it's been advertised as some of the secrets associated with human performance as far as strength and conditioning for rugby league and rugby union. I'd like to start by really saying that I have no magic ingredients. And when you look at particularly programs where people are looking for that that magic sort of idea, I think everyone can pick up things from every other sport. So I think, I was just talking to Kathy about it, that I guess one thing that I pride myself in that I don't stay in one tunnel vision in one sport and just draw from that one sport. Sports such as volleyball, such as soccer, such as netball, all have components of the conditioning programs which I can draw out and then utilize in some way, shape or form in rugby league or rugby union conditioning. So I think the more information you can draw from other sports, you've got the advantage of going to maybe to a track and field, speaking to track and field coaches, looking at what they do as far as their speed development, their power development is concerned, how you can actually apply that back to your individual sport and obviously the age group that you're working with. I think also that probably from a strength and conditioning coach's perspective, the first and foremost credo that I have and most strength and conditioning coaches have would be that you do no harm. So the aspect of minimization of risk of training injury and injury on the field is the number one priority of any program, no matter if you're working obviously with an under eights football team all the way through to elite level rugby league or rugby union at the highest highest professional level. Secondary to that would be the performance elements. And obviously if a player is injured, irrespective of their level of performance or their age group, then they can't do any of the training associated with improving performance. So if we can decrease the risk of a player becoming injured, and then overlay that with as far as the performance program is concerned, then we go a long way to actually getting the best possible optimal development out of that particular athlete. If you can imagine, these are actually looped under the power rack and then the end of it's pulled up and then hooked over the Olympic bar or whatever bar you're actually using. So that at a height, and I'm just under 6 foot, at a height of 6 foot, they provide 100 pounds of resistance at the top of the movement. As you squat, you can see they unload. So it returns back to its unstretched position and it unloads as you come down to the bottom position. So since the top end is where you're strongest, it provides the most resistance at the top end of the squat. Particularly if you're working with explosive athletes, who can actually accelerate out of the bottom position in the squat with an unloaded weight, it might be say 70 or 80 kilograms on the bar, but at the top of the movement, you're getting an additional 40 to 50 kilograms at the top of the movement. But a hamstring walk is just like a harbour bridge. So you start standing, hands go to the ground, walk the hands out as far as you can, and then walk the feet, and then out, and continue walking. And probably if it was on a field, maybe trial under 22 metre. What I want you to do, I'm going to drop this med ball, okay? I want your arms out. What you try and do is turn the movement, push it straight back to me as quickly as you can. So don't absorb it all the way to the chest, okay? Just drop it, and I'm going to drop it and then push straight back up. And we're going to do 5 reps. Ready? Go. Fast. Come on. Power. Come on. Up. Hit the roof. There you go. Good man. So again, working on the neural activation from the very heavy bench press, straight using the lighter med ball and attempting to turn the eccentric to the concentric as quickly as we possibly can associated with increasing power activation. If you get the opportunity to go and watch an NRL squad or a Super 12 team or train, look at the amount of speed work that players do in a team ball work session because it's flat out top pace. And often, it's still flat out top pace 48 hours before a game. Just run at me, gentlemen, or don't hit me too hard because that thing was going, don't hit me too hard. Boom. I'll take him that way. It's useless, me, trying to hit him and then trying to go like this because his momentum's going this way. I'm trying to rotate him this way. And if I get off balance, he's going to finish me off. He's going to be the dominant tackle. But if I decide to take him with me, I throw him hard onto the ground, there's every chance the ball's going to be jarred loose, or just go to the ground for me. Throw it in. Boom. I've bang, bang, up. Play the ball, go on from there. Or if I'm in a rugby league situation, I'm going to turn turtle, I'm going to here, I'm going to spin, and I'm going to get up in the marker position. But they also have to be fundamental. Otherwise, if you're working with kids, they won't do them. And if they're fun, they're going to be solid and they're going to improve. And thanks very much for coming on tonight. Thank you.
The smother tackle is an effective way to slow the release of the ball by driving firmly with the shoulder to make contact just above the ball and wrapping up your opponent. When going into a contact situation, the use of a power step will increase force and stability. For an effective front-on tackle, move forward, crouch by bending the knees, keep your eyes up and make firm contact with the shoulder just below the waist. Wrap your arms and drive with your legs.
Hip-buster, yes, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, you bring.
Yeah, shot lucky.
Yeah. Jump, Piers.
Miles. Yeah, ready, you bring.
Yeah, Andy.
By turning up the toes in contact and striking the ball near its point, backspin is put on the ball, enabling it to sit up for the chasers. Balance is important, with players binding to drive on either side of ball carrier, forming a wedge forward of the ball. Players in a maul must adopt a strong driving position, keeping to their feet with their hips below their shoulders.
At the International Rugby Board's conference on the playing of the game following Rugby World Cup 2003, which involved international coaches, players, referees, together with media representatives and administrators, one of the topics closely investigated was the tackle. The conference recognised the need to better inform the rugby world, including players, coaches, referees, the media and the public, on the technicalities of the tackle and the post-tackle. And to that end, Ian McGeachan, former international player, coach to the Scotland team and three times coach of the British and Irish Lions, now Director of Rugby for the Scottish Rugby Union, will take us through the tackle and post-tackle.
what must the tackled player do?
A tackled player must try to make the ball available immediately so that play can continue. A tackled player must immediately pass the ball or release it. That player must also get up or move away from it at once. A tackled player may release the ball by putting it on the ground in any direction, provided this is done immediately. A tackled player may release the ball by pushing it along the ground in any direction except forward, provided this is done immediately. If opposition players who are on their feet attempt to play the ball, the tackled player must release the ball.
Tackle made, ball down, ball away. Good. In this tackle situation, with the player going to ground quickly, he must get the ball away from him quickly and away from his body, so he creates the space around the ball at which he can play. In this example, the ball carrier goes to ground, delivers it very quickly with the support behind him, and creates quick face possession. Good. Now, we have a player who's been tackled, he's kept the ball in tight. This is a very difficult situation for the player on the ground. He's given his rights away, he's got to play the ball quickly, but he's holding it in. Now, the defender, on his feet, can get at the ball. In this example, the Scottish player takes the ball in on his own and again goes to ground early, which means he really has to release the ball quickly. He changes position on the floor to try and get in a stronger position, and the slow ball means inevitably a penalty against. In any incident where there is an isolated ball carrier going to ground quickly, the advantage will immediately move to the defenders who are on their feet. Now this time we've got contact, that's it. Man on the ground, but the ball comes through his legs. This is the squeeze ball with a square on tackle. And a quick ball means that it can be moved away. Now we have a contact situation wider out where the player is caught in line with the ball trapped underneath his body. If it's going to be squeeze ball, then the ball has to be pushed through the legs immediately. Tackle made, down he goes and caught. Now we've got the long position, but the ball's caught underneath. A player going in on his own will always be penalised if he doesn't free that ball up immediately. Here we have New Zealand player taking the ball into contact. He goes to ground quickly in line, but doesn't release the ball. Again, it's squeeze ball with the ball caught underneath him and isolated. The advantages are all with the defending players. What we have to remember is if any tackle happens wider out, without support, the ball has to be released quickly. If it is not released quickly, then invariably the ball carrier will be the one penalised. Here we have the South African ball carrier tackled early. The tackler moves away, but the ball carrier keeps the ball close, again psychologically giving the advantage to the two defenders who are on their feet.
This time it's in kicking range, and again a little flash of temper, holding on the floor from South Africa.
In this situation, the ball carrier goes to ground early with no support, and the fact that he's gone down early gives the psychological advantage to the defenders, who can put their hands on the ball.
What must the tackler do?
When a player tackles an opponent and they both go to ground, the tackler must immediately release the tackle player. The tackler must immediately get up or move away from the tackle player and from the ball. The tackler must get up before playing the ball.
Here we have an example where the ball carrier and the tackler are both on the ground together. The tackler on the ground on the opposition side makes no attempt at all to move away, and he's stopping the ball coming back. An obvious penalty. Here we have New Zealand taking the ball into contact and a Canadian player lays over the top. If a tackler gets himself in that position, then invariably he will be penalised by the referee.
Daniel Carter.
Here is a good example of a tackle being made by Australia's number one and then immediately rolling away from the tackle. Here we go. Tackle made. Now we've got the tackler. Great position. The ball's free. He can get up on his feet. Any side, he can pick that ball up, keep his back away to the opposition and play the ball away. Right, the tackler has the ability to play that ball from any direction, as long as he's on his feet. Good. Now I have high tackle. Okay, the players wrestle to the ground and the ball is free. This player is not a tackler, so he must play the ball from his own side. This player has to release it when he's on the ground. High tackle, ball carrier wrestle to the ground. Good. The defender wasn't the tackler, so he has to come and play the ball from his own side. He had to get round his own side, then he could play the ball. Good high tackle, man stopped, ball played immediately, penalty. As a player stopping the ball carrier, he wasn't the tackler, so he can only play it from his own side. Right, double tackle, well done. And the player on the ground can get up immediately, play the ball, ball away. High player making the tackle. If the player goes to ground, has to release him. Two passes, good double tackle. Top man over, right, has to leave him because he's not off his feet, he's not the tackler. Tackler gets up, plays the ball. Good turnover.
What must all players do after a tackle?
After a tackle, all other players must be on their feet when they play the ball. Players are on their feet if no other part of their body is supported by the ground or players on the ground. At a tackle, or near to a tackle, other players who play the ball must do so from behind the ball and from behind the tackle player or the tackler closest to those players' goal line. Any player who gains possession of the ball at the tackle must play the ball immediately by moving away or passing or kicking the ball. Any player who first gains possession of the ball must not go to the ground at the tackle or near to it unless tackled by an opposition player. Any player who first gains possession of the ball at the tackle or near to it may be tackled by an opposition player, providing that player does so from behind the ball and from behind the tackle player or tackler nearest that player's goal line. After a tackle, any player lying on the ground must not prevent an opponent from getting possession of the ball. After a tackle, any player on the ground must not tackle an opponent or try to tackle an opponent.
What must players not do?
No player may prevent the tackle player from releasing the ball and getting up or moving away from it. No player may fall on or over the tackled player.
In this example, as the Irish player is tackled, his first supporting player immediately goes off his feet to secure the ball on his side of the ball. This will always be penalised. 10 metres short for Ireland. Here we have an instance in which the Tongan player goes to ground quickly because he falls over, but immediately the Welsh players arriving come off their feet. If the first Welsh player had have stepped over the Tongan on the ground, he would have actually had control of space around the ball, and there would have been a turnover and possession for Wales. In this instance, at the tackle, the Irish support players are on their feet when they make contact and drive beyond the ball carrier, although their momentum takes them to the ground after the point of contact. They have created a lot of space around the ball. Again, it is easy for the scrum half to see the ball and the referee to referee it.
Good. Now our tackle situation, ball free, and support player comes straight off his feet to cover the ball. Right, immediate penalty. Okay, good pass. Okay, tackle made. Support player straight off his feet, diving on the ball, his side of the ball. All right, what we're trying to not do is get any support player off his feet this side of the tackle. Okay, if you're this side of the tackle and the ball's free, you should be stepping through it. So if we go off your feet this side, you'll always get a penalty against you. Good tackle, ball available, support player. Right, all the weight now, same thing. All right, we're sealing the ball off. What we're trying to get is the support player coming in is either clearing the space or picking the ball up. Right? If he doesn't do either and he just sits there and covers the ball, it's almost like a squeeze ball where you've got the ball trapped underneath the body, and referees will penalise that. Good. Tackle situation, player in, good lift. Great. First support player stayed on his feet, took the first defender away. There's the space. All right, for the next player. And that's what we want to try and do, all right, is the space around the ball is to try and clear it. So definite decisions for that first support player.
Here, the Australian ball carrier takes the ball into contact, stays on his feet a little bit longer. The support comes over the top on their feet, and it's very easy to see the clear space that they've created around the ball. Makes it very easy to referee.
If the ball's on the ground there, that some people like, you know, if you're coming at it like this, what you want to try and do is say, get there quickly, but your last metre, you do, or 2 metres, you actually do a little circle, so you come in square on. Because it's like looking down a gun rifle sight, that if you're coming there, you can actually see everything. If you're coming there, you're blinded, and if you actually hit, you're in a poor position. And if the more times that the ball's available and you can come at it like that, you're actually in the strongest position, because if somebody arrives at the same time, you don't have to change anything. All you do is you just leave the ball and get rid of the man. Now, if you're the second man, so if the first man does that, he does that, right, and I'm the second man, go on, over you go, I'm still doing the same, right, he's cleared the space, I can have the ball up, okay? If there's two men coming in, there's the ball again, right? You've got to make a decision now, right? Go on, over the ball. Right, I've got to go over the ball. You have it up, okay? Or if you make contact, and it's a big contact, because it's a big player, all right? So you have to stick there, but you're still on your feet, all right? And I come up here, Right, now we're clear, so we're doing it. So all the decisions are being made in that channel, straight behind the ball. All right, that's what we're after. So the support players, and you don't have to come in a big loop round. All right, you're trying to get there, a good run, a good line to wherever the ball is, and then just in the last 2 or 3 metres, you get yourself in the gun sight, right down the gun sight, because that's where you make your best decisions. That's it. Good tackle made, right square, clear, lifting, good. That's it. And when you think about defenders, now everybody talks about getting somebody in behind, pillars in, and you all start measuring that way, right? And somebody gets a really good clearance here, and you get a pickup like that, you can suddenly be 10 metres that way, and you've got a scrambling defence trying to stop you, all right? It won't always work because you know, you've got bodies in that area as well. But if you're doing that, at worst, you're clearing the ball. At worst, the ball's there, tidy. The referee can see it, scrum half can see it, and you're off, you're playing somewhere else. If you stop on a ball, scrum half can't see it, can't play it, referee can't, he's likely to start making penalty decisions, right? And there's likely to go against as much as four. So that's what you want to take. Take those decisions out of a sort of lottery of what's happening. So the better you can be there, it's safer to play in because you're making better decisions, but it's easier to referee as well. Good tackle, ball clear, man cleared out. That's great clearing. Right, when the defender was coming up, the contact was made here. He's ended up on the floor there. There is nothing illegal about that. That is good rugby because he's clearing the space where the ball is, and it means that we can be playing either picking through the contact or actually linking away. Often, if a arriving player comes here, right, and he ends up wrestling, and actually that's a weak position because now all I can try and do is, if he resists, go and resist me, right, I'm going to try and spin him and drag him. That's impossible. All right, I'm in a very weak position. Now if you get your hands on the ball, right, now what I'm looking all the time is at shoulders. If I can get below wherever the shoulders are, then I start to get in a dominant position. And this is anybody now, because it could happen on the wing. I mean, everybody's got to be able to do it. Here we have the Fijian player tackled, presenting the ball well, but an excellent position from the USA defensive player. Unfortunately, puts his hands on the ball when he could have driven the supporting Fijian players off the ball completely. Here, the Uruguayan player goes to ground early, and the South African, on his feet, stays below the arriving support players from Uruguay. He has control of the situation over and around the ball. So if you've got your hands on the ball, okay, if I come in here, now what I want to do is, I just put your hands on the ball, is if his shoulders are there, I want you to get his hands. So he's going low, I'm going shoulder to shoulder, right, and I just squeeze his hands, right, and in the same action, I've actually got him up. Okay, now before, there's no way I could move. If I go over you and try and wrestle you away, right, I might fall. But actually, there's no way I'm in control of the contact or what we're doing. Whereas if you, I mean, you're in a good position. Just get down here, just keep your arms long. Just bend over as though you're right, you've gone for ball straight away. Okay, now that's the one where you just get, as long as you get in here, you look at the shoulders as a contact. Now, I can go here, but what I've got to be able to do is I've got to be able to get those off. Okay, so I don't try and knock him away. I actually just try and get his hands away. And if you do like a scissor motion, it's very difficult. But people resist that way. If you actually do a scissor motion, you just take hands off the ball. And it also lifts him, which gives you the position that you can actually start driving. So when it looks as though you're thinking, crikey, this is impossible, he's got his hands on the ball, he's going to get... And you actually forget ball, just go for his arms. And by doing that, you lift him, and you get a natural target for your shoulder as well. So you just clear, and it becomes a very efficient way of clearing somebody very quickly. Good pass. Tackle, support player in, hands on ball. That's it. Player cleared out. That's good. Hands on ball, first support player, all he did was target the arms and lift the player out. The fact that you're going underneath or you're aiming for his hands and his wrists is that you're going below his shoulders. And it's actually not a comfortable position because you're standing there with your head vulnerable, and then you know there's somebody actually attacking this bit. And it's a peculiar position because if somebody's driving at your wrists and your arms, it's actually a peculiar feeling. You know, it's uncomfortable, and your reaction is to actually just come away. So as somebody does that, you actually come away a bit, which allows the drive then. It just allows you a nice place for your shoulder, and you get rid of him quite easily. That's it. Good tackle. Right, we've got hands on ball. Go for it. That's it. Well done. Okay. It's those split-second decisions, every tackle. Next support player going for ball. Next support player in attack, actually making sure those hands can't stay anywhere near it. And if you look at all good drives, or whether it's a counter drive in a line out from a forwards mauling, generally if you suddenly go above your opponent, they've got control whether you've got the ball or not. So it's that, just in a one-to-one or a two-on-two situation, that if you can get two players who just get into that strong position, you get the drive on. Good tackle. Man in. Good. That's it. That's it. Well done. So the first support plate, definitely shoulders below. Strongest position. All right. And it then, as long as you've gone past the ball, it actually doesn't matter where you end up with him, just because it's clear. Now, even if there's another player coming in and the next player does the same, or as often happens in game, you get two players arriving almost at the same time, as long as the first player is accurate, the second player can bind on him, because you've actually got a reference point over contact. So you can build a really quick drive or a quick rock just by the position of the first player. And as long as you're staying on your, like that, staying on your feet, you know, there'd be more coming. You wouldn't be able to knock him away as quickly. But the fact that you've got yourself in the best position there, somebody cannot bind in on you this side and somebody come in that side, you're through. Three players, suddenly you've got that space won, ball away. And everything's on the feet, but from an attacking point of view, the most important thing is everything's happening half a yard in front of the ball. You're not doing anything that's stopping on the ball, and that's what you should be trying to sort of build up again. You know, every time you get a tackle, either you get the ball free or you win the space. You know, when you've stayed on your feet and we've got two or three players who are arriving at the same time, and you end up two or three of you going down together, so he's almost trapped, and you're trying to just clear him. It's actually clear him to the side rather than clear him forward. It's actually just clear him to the side so your support players can come through. And the support player there, getting rid of the tackler, arrives straight away, ends up on the ground, past the ball. Player arriving has just tried to lift the player in the way, out of the way. He's not tried to go off his feet. He's tried to be very positive about clearing that space.
All players forming, joining, or taking part in a ruck must be on their feet.
Free kick, back, head and shoulders.
Players in a ruck must do their best to stay on their feet. A player must not intentionally fall or kneel in a ruck. This is dangerous. There are two offside lines parallel to the goal lines, one for each team. Each offside line runs through the hindmost foot of the hindmost player in the ruck. Players must either join a ruck or retire behind the offside line immediately. All players joining a ruck must do so from behind the foot of the hindmost teammate in the ruck. The player may join alongside this hindmost player. If the player joins the ruck from the opponent's side or in front of the hindmost teammate, the player is offside.
One goal, in from the side.
Yeah,
here we go. We've got a tackle there. It's a long tackle. We've got ball carrier, tackler like this. Now you have a gate for arriving players, which is that wide. That's where you're trying to come in and take the ball. And the same, that players arriving from the other side, okay, have a gate there which they come in. So if you start coming in from the side, then that's when the referee will pick up the line. So that's the gates at the tackle. That's a long tackle, which means that support players do have to be coming round. It's back to the gun sight again. You know, there's the ball. Let's get in behind the ball, because I know I'm fine. I'm in the strongest position anyway, and I'm in the right position. I can never be penalised. Okay? All right, this time, that's fine. We've now got a tackle here. Right, there's the tackler. Right, that's the ball carrier. Now we've got a wider gate. So if you're coming in now, in that position, again, as long as you've got the ball in your gun sights, even if you're arriving from here, you come here and you're in on ball. Or from here, you can be coming in, all right, because you know there's the last feet, there's the tackler, I know I can come in here. Players arriving that side, same thing. Okay, you can see the ends, the limits of where the tackle is, and as long as you come in inside those gates, which determine the limits, you're okay. If we go to contact and I put a ball back there, or I get isolated out on the wing, right, there's no way I can keep hold of ball, right? But as I go down, what I do is I push it back, because that's where I expect the support to be. So all the time, you know, if you're the first support player, that is where you're expected to be. And if you're in that channel the whole time, you've got the best chance of controlling the ball. Tackle there, gates. That's it. Now you're going to keep grouping up. Keep grouping. Go on. Tackle. Gate. Have a look at the feet we're in. Okay. Tackle. Gate. Good. Tackle again. Gate. Good. Ball away. Well, cleared. Gate again. Okay, again, coming from the side. Not picking the gate up on the back feet. Good tackle. Gate. One. Good. Right, follow him in. Gate again. Good. Gonna go following him, Mick. That's it. Gate. Coming from the side, not picking the gate up. Right, supporting players arriving through the gate, over the ball, step. Make contact, bind, wait and hold. Okay, we've now got a ruck, so we've now got the back feet marked. Okay. And this one's there. Okay, this player was onside at the tackle, he's now offside at the ruck, okay, and should move back to the back foot. So as the ruck goes through, right, continue pushing, ball's free, he goes for ball, but offside. In this example, although the Fijian ball carrier goes to ground quickly, his support is immediately behind him on his feet and driving through the contact of the ball. This changes the offside line for the defence, which catches the French scrum half out. If you get tackled early and you're sometimes isolated, you have to present the ball quickly, because you go to ground quickly. You're actually losing the rights you have as a ball carrier. which is why a lot of the coaching is to try and stay on your feet. But to be able to do that, the referee is going to be trying to get himself in position, so whenever the play is there, it's slightly in front of him, but he can actually see the ball carrier going into contact, so he can actually make that decision. So if the ball carrier doesn't present it, or the tackler hangs on to the ball, doesn't release him to play it, it can actually be seen. So it's those first two decisions that are always in view. The referee's following the ball in, he's following the ball, he can see it, he's following the ball again, there's the next tackle, he can still see the ball, he's now in the defensive line, he's going to have to come back. Tackle there, Gates! It's down. Well, good placement, good defence, tackle.
From January 1st, 2007, the scrummage laws around engagement will change to a four-stage verbal call. The referee will call crouch, then touch. The front rows will crouch, and using their outside arm, each prop touches the point of the opposing prop's outside shoulder. The referee will then call pause. Following a pause, the referee will then call engage. The front rows may then engage. The engage call is not a command, but an indication that the front rows may come together when ready. Let's look at the Pacific Islands rugby team and St. Michael's College Dublin under-16s practice the engagement sequence. Let's look at the four stages in some more detail.
Crouch!
The referee will call crouch, and players must crouch into position, ready to engage safely.
Touch!
The referee will call touch, and the props from both teams will touch their opposition prop on the point of their outside shoulder. This will ensure a consistent distance between the front rows. After the touch has been made, the arms are withdrawn.
Pause!
The referee will call pause, and the players will pause prior to the engage call. This will ensure safe timing of engagement.
Engage!
The players will engage when they are ready.
Crouch! Touch! Pause, engage!
These law changes apply to senior, under 19, and sevens law. Thanks to the Pacific Island rugby team, St. Michael's College under 16s, and Alan Lewis and David Keane from the Leinster branch of the Irish Rugby Union for their support.
It's the Rugby WA Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink, thanks to Quick Transport and Crane Hire.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. This 1v1 drill focuses on leg drive, ball security and ball placement. Starting in a low position, the ball carrier picks up both balls and gets a good shoulder lead on the defender. The attacker then continues driving their legs, attempting to break the tackle. When the attacker finally gets tackled, he recoils his body and performs a long place with both balls. Remember, practice the skill and not the drill.
It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA, thanks to Force 15.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. This is a continuous drill that focuses on an attacking arrival identifying a defensive threat. The attacking player needs to enter the gate and ensure they step past the ball in a strong position. As the threat approaches the tackle contest, the attacker needs to make strong contact and clean out past the ball. Always ensure that the players have their heads up and eyes forward. Remember, practice the skill and not...
That was Drill of the Week, thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA. It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA, thanks to Force 15.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. This is a 4-on-4 drill that focuses on the defenders making decisions whilst fatigued. A half-back
plus four attackers set up an attacking raid whilst the defenders perform a rugby-relevant activity. On the coach's call, the defenders form a defensive line and attempt to shut down the attack. This can be repeated with various activities and by adding or subtracting attackers and defenders. Emphasis should be placed on the defenders communicating and remaining in a line. Remember, practice the skills and not the drill.
That was Drill of the Week, thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA. It's Drill of the Week with Matthew Tink from Rugby WA, thanks to Force 15.
Hi, I'm Matt Tink from Rugby WA. This is a low-impact clean-out drill that focuses on players using correct technique to remove a threat over the ball. The ball carrier lays between two players and rolls away to one side, making contact with a player. This player immediately springs to his feet and assumes the jackal position. The ball carrier then long places the ball. The third player attempts to remove the threat by getting in a strong low position and driving past the ball. Remember, practice the skill and not the drill.
That was Drill of the Week, thanks to Force 15 and Rugby WA.
Defender quickly moves to the one side of the grid and attempts to prevent the attackers scoring a try. Key coaching points for the defender are hands up and move forward on the inside of the ball carrier, keeping eyes on hips or shorts. Balance forward on the balls of the feet, bend through hips and knees to allow rapid change of direction. Feet in close to the attacker when pushing, avoid extending the arms. Keep moving feet through the push.
Welcome. This video will teach you more about the sport of rugby. But first, we asked a few people this question. What is rugby?
It was made up by the Irish in like the 20s. Pretty sure. In a drunken rage, they just started tackling each other and running around with their pints.
Awkward. I can't perform on the spot.
Well, rugby is a sport of power and play and muscles and legs and arms, and it's a great way to get close to someone. Rugby is an awesome sport. I like it.
I'm sorry?
No.
No? Rugby didn't...
I'm at work. It's a sport.
I think rugby is a sport that was invented by the Vikings back in the 1720s. And they used to play it from ship to ship, you know, walk the planks and all that. It's a mix between, you know, soccer, volleyball, soccer, hockey, football, basketball, lacrosse, pigeon hunting. A little bit of football, swimming, more like diving really, and lacrosse, so that's right.
Yeah, it's a game that started in Italia, and I think it was San Lorenzo, and the meatball company, that the pizzeria, they were fighting and making huge meatballs. And like they got into a fight, and they started to just like throw the meatballs at each other, but they got kind of messy, you know.
Heads up! So
mamma mia!
Pretty sure the first game was played between the Finnish British lords and the Scottish lairds in the Bearded Hills. Yeah, I'm pretty sure Nessie was their mascot. Yeah, they played with the kilts on and the bags were bagpipes.
Rugby? Rugby is a gentle sport, first invented in 1942 by the African-American Negro, then stolen by the white man around the 60s, Jim Crow. That's it.
Rugby was created in 1813 at Rugby College by a group of college students who played soccer. And one of them happened to pick it up and run with it in a gentlemanly fashion. That, my friends, is how rugby was created.
Excuse me. Do you know how rugby started?
I think it started in China. Men were fighting over some sake and started throwing sushi at each other. I don't know, but I'm pretty sure your coach, Dr. Freak, was a part of the first team in 1813. Just get off of me!
And look across.
Let's take a look at some of the basics of rugby, starting with the rugby pitch. The pitch is 100 meters long with a try line on each end of the field. A rugby team may be comprised of many players, but there are only 15 allowed per side on the field at a time. They are comprised of forwards, backs, and Rachels.
Get out of here!
Before you begin, here are a few things you'll need.
This is what you need for rugby. A mouth guard. You insert it like this. Next, you need a pair of fancy shorts. Rugby Imports is the place to get them. They don't rip. They're nice. But the most important thing, you need the cleats. Get shiny cleats with a little bit of bedazzled gold on the side, so you run and it's like a blur, and no one knows, hey, what are those? It's like a gold fiasco. No, it's just your cleats.
In rugby, unlike football, the ball is only thrown backwards, and a game is comprised of two 40-minute halves made up of running, sort of running, still running, running some more. And did we mention running? Passing, where the ball, again, is only thrown backwards. Tackling. Rugby also does not use padding. Rucking.
Unlike the pell-belly game of football, when someone gets tackled, the play doesn't stop. Ah! Oh, sorry.
Lineouts. This is what happens when the ball goes out of bounds and must be thrown back in.
Chicken power, 72!
Scrums, which happen after a penalty. Kicking, and finally scoring. There are 5 points for a try and 2 points for the kick after. We hope this video has shown you more about rugby, and we look forward to seeing you on the field shortly.
Yes, dog. Yeah. I doubt whether any referee would rule an infringement for either of the passes we have just seen. However, if one was to use the criteria that a forward pass occurs when the ball travels forward from the point of release, then both of the passes we have just seen would be forward passes. Let's have a closer look. Similar passes to those seen will be made, but now reference lines 1 meter apart have been marked on the Ballymore turf to help us see exactly how the ball moves after it leaves the passer's hands. In the first instance, the players are only jogging, and the lateral type pass is quite short, about 3 meters in length. In slow motion, the ball can be seen to travel forward about 1 meter before being caught by the receiver. This time the players are running a little faster, and the pass is over a distance of about 4 to 5 meters. Once again, the slow motion replay quite clearly shows that the ball travels forward in the air about 2 meters. The last pass is a longer one of around 10 to 12 meters, and the players are now running at near top speed. In this case, the ball travels forward nearly 5 meters. Did the player making the pass throw the ball forward? Watch the pass again and notice that the ball moves in a direct line between the passer and the receiver, and the ball is always travelling backwards relative to the moving players. Let's now look at another type of pass that is quite common in rugby, the overhead pass. Surely passing the ball back over one's head while running towards the opponent's goal line cannot possibly be ruled as an infringement. Yet notice that once again, the ball travels forward relative to the ground. so that according to most people's stated understanding of a forward pass, an infringement has occurred. Passes made during a game, in circumstances similar to the ones we have just seen, thankfully are never ruled as forward passes. In all of these cases, the receiver continues along his running line, and without the grid lines present, the illusion that the ball moves backwards is created. Let's see if we can develop a better understanding of exactly what is happening. In this computer animation, both passer and receiver are stationary, and the ball travels over the ground in exactly the same direction as the passer throws it. Now our players are moving. The pass is made in exactly the same direction and with exactly the same speed as before. But because of the forward movement of the player carrying the ball's resultant motion over the ground is a combination of the passer's running motion and the motion of the pass. Math students among you will recognize this as a typical relative velocity situation. In this case, the ball ends up traveling directly across the field, despite being passed backwards. In the final animation, the player's running speed is increased, but the speed and the direction of the pass again remain the same, and now the resultant movement of the ball is noticeably forward. The ball travels forward, not because the player passes it forward, but simply because he was running forward. So according to the law, a referee must judge a forward pass purely on the passing action of the passer and not be influenced by the movement of the ball relative to the ground. By highlighting the passing action in the situation seen previously, notice that in accordance with the law, they are perfectly legitimate. Now let's look at the most common match situation in which passers are nearly always incorrectly ruled as forward. Once the passer's forward motion is halted by a solid hit or a tackle, he no longer remains in front of the receiver, and the illusion that the ball travels backwards is broken, the ball readily being seen to go forward. The ball is caught in front of where it was passed, this point being indicated by the area in which the passer was tackled. Suddenly, spectators call out a forward pass, but again, there has been no infringement, because the passer did not throw the ball forward. This pass is exactly the same as the one we have just investigated, the only difference being that the passer is not stopped in a tackle. Let's look now at a real demonstration. The illusion that the ball is being thrown forward is again very strong, but in each case, when the passer is highlighted and the movement of the ball seen in slow motion, the passing action is not forward, and hence the passers are indeed legitimate. A final important point. Players become conditioned not to throw passes forward, and they very rarely ever do so. When players are running at near top speed, it is virtually impossible for the support player to catch a pass that has been thrown forward of the direct line between the passer and the receiver, as demonstrated here. Notice also how the passing action is clearly forward and looks awkward and indeed looks forced. Ryan Constable, the passer, had three attempts before he managed to deliberately pass the ball forward of the line he would quite subconsciously have chosen.
Someday. Right. You run. Well done, Patrick. Here, pass. Go, pass. That's it, Ben.
I'm okay.
Hold on, that's it.
Pass it to himself,
pass.
Okay, stop there. Stop there. Calm, you go back up there.
No.
Go on, make it a bit more difficult. You ready?
What did you do? You did me, Gregor.
Right, you ready? Go on. The guy that's got to receive the ball has to be ready and have the hands out for the ball, okay? Stuart, you're going to have to be standing like that. You ready? Go. That's it. Two hands, Dennis. No, you can't hold the ball. That. Two hands. That's it. That's better, Dennis. Okay, hands back. Good boy.
Push him forward.
Stay behind him, Callum. Chase him.
Right, give you 10, Ben. 1.
Chase him, Callum.
2.
Go on.
3.
Chase him.
Aguirre! Yeah!
Well done.
Stay
okay.
On
the line.
Don't break the lights.
Right. Yeah. Who's got the sharks?
Pay attention. Andrew, you want it. No, you can't see the ball. Keep going.
No, keep going. Keep through it. You've got that side. Okay.
Stand still.
Matthew, look.
That's one card.
Yes, they play a game for the last 15 minutes or something like that. Skills for the players. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Callum, don't tell them what you're going to do. Okay, ready, go. Two passes,
remember.
Callum!
Play on.
Good pass.
Hey, Ben.
Whoa.
She's off.
Get him on.
You two back, we back over there.
There's a nice defensive line.
Callum, in the line. In the line, Callum. In line with Patrick, Callum.
Watch him, Bruce. Do a okay. Tap.
Ready? Right, on you go, Bruce.
Matthew! Robert!
Callum, get behind him. Get behind him, Callum.
Robert! Robert! Robert!
Robert!
Robert!
Robert! Robert!
Robert! Robert! Robert!
Pass the ball, Ben.
Pass the ball, Ben. That's good.
Tap
that's
him.
Good.
Pass the ball,
Stuart.
Go on, Ben.
Ben, turn round, turn round. That's okay.
Come on, Greg. Greg. Come on. Good play. Good play. Join it.
So what about this side?
Important, Ben. Well done, Greg. Well done, Greg. Well done.
Patrick, you stay out. Who's going to come to you, Patrick, from us? Yeah?
Like
this side. Ben. Let's get it. Let's get it.
Watch
the game. Watch the game.
Oh, great.
Play on.
Play on.
Robert!
Oh, get Ben.
Call Andrew.
Go on, Robert.
Lovely.
Yeah, that's Kenneth, that's it.
Stay in your line.
Ball
in. Pass it back, Greg. Get the ball back, Greg.
Right, throw it down,
hurry up.
Right,
Callum, come in, close the gap. Right, so. Play on.
That's it, well done, Ben.
Right,
come on,
keep going.
Come on, back
your
line. That's it.
Yeah.
Come on, Andy, pick it up and go.
Up on your feet, boys, on your feet. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Massi, tocco. Pausa!
Secondo me la cosa più bella del pilone è la mischia, l'ingaggio della mischia, la parte iniziale.
Pausa! Ingaggio!
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6!
L'assegnazione della mischia.
La mischia è il braccio.
Se uno dice io sono nella mischia, immagina la zuffa.
Sì.
È giusto o la mischia è un'altra cosa?
È una zuffa con tante regole, una zuffa ordinata.
3, 4, 5,
contatto!
6, 7, 8. È un equivoco linguistico. Noi chiamiamo mischia una zuffa. A rugby, mischia è un modo ordinato di riprendere il gioco dopo un'infrazione.
C'è in avanti qua, non c'è vantaggio.
Bassi, tocco. Pausa, ingaggio.
La mischia è fatta di 8 giocatori per parte, legati insieme fra di loro. Prima, seconda e terza linea, legati insieme.
Il primo personaggio che va in mischia è il tallonatore. Alza le braccia, i due piloni devono abbracciarlo prendendo le braghette e infilare le mani qua. A questo punto entrano le seconde linee che si inginocchiano.
La destra sotto lì, quello del ginocchio.
Ok. Terza linea. Spiega.
A questo punto ci sono le terze, che però vengono messe in questa posizione qui e vanno giù nel momento in cui si appoggia la mischia.
Mentre dietro c'è una specie di domatore, di cocchiere.
Sono io che comando la spinta.
Spingono tutti attaccati insieme, questo è fondamentale. Devono fare un corpo solo e la pressione che esercitano è enorme.
Ma! E poi si spinge.
Tra i due gruppi, quando si legano, resta un tunnel, qui. Quello che introduce la palla è un uomo della mischia, il 9. Si chiama mediano di mischia. Lui introduce la palla, è questa, gialla, va bene? La palla viene lanciata dentro il tunnel e
il giocatore col numero 2 la deve tallonare. Lui ha un tallone d'Achille al contrario, è il suo punto di forza il tallone d'Achille. Prende la palla e inizia a tirarla indietro tra le gambe dei suoi compagni. Quando la palla esce, poi te la giochi. È un equivoco linguistico, perché mischia in realtà a rugby è una cosa molto, molto ordinata.
Pausa, ingaggio!
Passi, fermi, tocco, contatto!
Don't run through the poles! Come on, let's go!
Don't fall, you guys, you're getting tired!
We're carrying a
bargain now. Keep it up!
I wouldn't come through, I've got a few watches.
Four times. The bag's got to keep moving, though! Yeah, everybody runs four times, that bag's got to keep moving. So the last one's finished. Who's on the bag here? Who's on the bag? Too many people resting down the other side now.
Somebody else up here!
Where's the video?